on the placentation, on the organ development, and in the gamete and the embryo. And it has effects on the DNA methylation and the release of the various histones, which are very, very important. This is all science, which I'm talking about, because this is where we need to connect. Now, when we talk about BMI, a lot of these women will come to us who are very obese, very anxious to conceive. And what do we do? We start writing clomiphene citrate right away. We don't really realize what can be the impact of that obesity or of that undernutrition on when she gets pregnant. And we are ready to face the world. But our timely advice at that point of time is going to make a lot of difference on what we are going to face later on in life, which is important, and what they are going to face later on in life with their children and their future generations. So we see that low BMI associated with IUGR, preterm deliveries. India, for your kind information, is the capital again of premature deliveries. We have the highest number of preterm babies delivering in our country, and also iron deficiency anemia. Small surveys we have done, 40%, 50%, even half of you are going to be anemic. We don't even look after ourselves, which is important for us to understand. And high BMI will again lead to infertility, gestational diabetes, hypertension, birth defects, and so on, and many, many more diseases. When I was talking about clomiphene citrate and obesity and infertility, because 15% of our population is infertile, and we don't know what those have an impact on. And that's again important. And this research has really brought out a lot of things which are very important for us to understand. And if you see here, if you see, maternal obesity affects oocyte quality and embryo growth. Now, I'll go a little further ahead and I'll show you. Now, if you see here, altered diet, inflammation, and toxins. Now, if we have dietary fat, which is more in our diet, increases the lipid droplets and composition of the oocyte. If you have lipid sugars, they'll alter the mitochondrial activity of the oocyte. And similarly, micronutrients will have a direct impact on the modification of the DNA, which that seed is going to transmit. We go further ahead. I'll show you these eggs. These are eggs, and this is what you're looking at, is the fat stain. Now, go ahead and see a little more further. Now, this is an egg with the mitochondrial stain, and that's a normal diet person. Now, one who has had a high fat diet, look at the mitochondria. What has happened? Look at the fat stain. What has happened to the oocyte? So the impact is there, which we don't think. We keep on thinking, why this patient is having repeated implantation failures, or why this patient is having repeated abortions? We are not even thinking. And if we think also, most of the times we are thinking for the mother. We don't pay any attention to the parent, father. And men's weight also is important. If you see here, the male BMI, again, has a contribution to the decreased pregnancy rates. They have an increased pregnancy loss where the father or the husband is, you know, having high BMI. And also the quality of the embryos of those of us who do IVF is much worse. And we keep on blaming, we don't know where. So we have to understand these things. So paternal obesity, also along with all that, has a contribution in the offspring developing glucose intolerance later on in life. So it's not only the mother's obesity, but even the father's obesity is a contributor to it. What those of us, I do IVF, so I have a little bit of data on that. So when we do IVF, there are various contributory factors which will actually have an impact on the outcome of the embryos which develop. Now, there's so many things which happen. There's so many variables which happen, like nutrition, toxins, infection, smoking, weight, stress, and the procedure of ART itself, and even the alcohol intake, all have an impact on the development of the embryos in vitro. So you can imagine what is happening. And all this will again have a contributory factors, which they'll start in the prenatal period, into the perinatal and adult childhood factors, they all have an impact on the adult health and outcomes. Now, I am not talking anything new. If some of you have read this novel, The Brave New World, which was written by Aldous Huxley in 1932, almost 50 years before ART actually came into existence. And what did he say? It was fiction, but it's coming true. He said that, you know, we are going to have a broth where we'll put the ingredients and we will bring out babies which will be actually capable of standing a particular environment. Let's say chemical engineers or, you know, people who are going to work in the chemical factories. We'll make a broth where they'll be able to stand all the problems or the chemicals or the radiation much better. Similarly, the pilots for the rockets, they will be able to stand the gravity much better, the changes in the gravity much better. And all that is coming true today. BBC came out with a program which said there's a ghost in our genes. And they, long time back, this program said that, you know, the lives which our grandparents lived, the air which they breathed, the food which they ate, even the things which they saw can have a direct effect decades later on our future generations. I don't think I'm talking anything else. When we say hypertension in pregnancy, you definitely know the risk of later cardiovascular disease is going to be much more. The cerebrovascular disease is going to be much more, and kidney diseases are all linked to it with hypertension in pregnancy. Gestational diabetes predicts an increased risk to the developing of cardiovascular diseases, and even type 1 and type 2 diabetes. So we all understand that. And prematurity of infants born less than 32 weeks have a very strong correlation between prematurity and cardiovascular complications, regardless of whatever the birth weight may be. Hyperhomocysteinemia. We talked a lot about it a few years back. Again, we've forgotten. But if we understand that if there is hyperhomocysteine, levels are much more than what we really need, if they are more or equal to, like, you know, 12 micromoles, then the adverse if obstetric outcomes like abortions, by like neural tube defects, like other congenital deformities are going to be much, much higher. So here we are, that we as obstetricians have, or we spend almost about 9 months with the patient, and many a times we spend much more than that, because once, if the patient is infertile, she definitely comes much later, and post delivery also with the second child, and also that association, we are the only ones who are spending so much time with the patient. But is our time being utilized well? Now, when we talk about a standard program for antenatal care, we talk about at least a minimum of 4 visits, which WHO tells us. But I'm sure all of us, we have a lot of patients where we are spending much more time with them. Every month they come, sometimes we call them every 15 days also. And on an average, how much time do we spend with the patient? 1.5 minutes. What is a prescribed time which you should be actually focusing on the antenatal care or the history taking, especially in the first visit? Normally WHO says about 46 minutes. But even if you don't have that much time, because see, most of the times when I talk of this, the reply or the retort which I get from everyone is, where is the time? We don't have time. There's so many patients. We can't spend so much time with the patient. But we are not alone. Whether we are in the medical colleges or we are in our clinics, we have thousands of people to help us. Only thing is that we always think that we are alone. I only have to do it. It's not only you who has to do it. You have a whole team of your juniors, colleagues, of paramedical help, who are all going to have to be into it, to be able to provide that kind of care which our women deserve. And that's important. So that is the thought process change which I need all of you to bring into. A few years back, we used to talk institutional deliveries is the one which will bring about the change or decrease in the maternal mortality and morbidity. We did definitely bring in a lot of decrease in the maternal mortality. It's important. And that change was brought in when we started propagating at least a minimum of 4 antenatal visits. So we also see that as soon as the antenatal number of antenatal visits increased, the institutional delivery rate increased and the maternal mortality rate decreased. But we also understand that today we are struggling to bring it down further. We have not been able to go down to the level where we actually expected. So there again needs introspection on what changes have to be done. So if you see here, maternal mortality rate has definitely come down. The institutional delivery has had an impact on the neonatal mortality rate also, but we still haven't achieved the targets which we were supposed to. So what is it that one high quality intervention which you and I can actually collaborate and bring about to that those maternal and child health services which will actually have an impact not only on the babies or on the objectives which we are really wanting to achieve, but will also have far-reaching health and economic benefits. And that is important for us to understand, because what I'm talking, I'm sure you will all say, what is new? Ye toh hume sab pata hi tha. But is knowing enough? Knowing is not enough. We must apply it, which is important, because we know, but are we really applying? Willing is not enough. We must do it. And that is why my folded hands, thanks to all of you. All of you, you care for the women of our country. That's why you are here. And that's where the change is going to come. And each one of you are going to contribute to that change. You are the ambassadors. This TOT is for you. You're going to bring that change and inspire other people around you, whether it is your colleagues or your health workers or your housekeeping staff, whosoever. That inspiration has to come from you. So those of you who heard the Murli in the morning, because a lot of people said, what is it? You know, why the spirituality? Unless and until that spirituality inside us is woken up, because it's all there. I'm not doing anything new. Neither are the Brahma Kumaris or anybody else doing anything new. Only we have forgotten. It's all inside us, and we have to wake it up and bring that change, because this period of 9 months or 1 year is a critical window of opportunity for us to bring in the change in the future generations. As we always follow, you know, the West, this Nicolaides hypothesis, I don't know how many postgraduates, we used to keep on mugging it up. Oh, the pyramid of health. And what that pyramid of health actually used to say? First trimester, maximum impact. What have we understood now? First trimester has an impact, but what we need to add into this pyramid is a basement and a penthouse. We all strive for the penthouse. And that penthouse is very important, because this penthouse means what? It means pre-pregnancy or preconception care. And the basement means post-pregnancy care. Both are important along with the antenatal care, because there's so many things which we can achieve. And every time the patient comes to you is an opportunity which God has given us to utilize to actually start achieving or moving closer to our goals. And we should never lose those small opportunities which come our way. So when I was talking in the morning and I was saying, somebody said, you know, when I'm talking to the patient, my mind is going here and there and thinking of 1,000 other things. Now, when you come and sit on your seat, your mind should only think about your patients, on the change which you will bring in your patients and on the change which you will bring in the future generation. You have to leave all your problems aside. You have to leave your mobile aside. and concentrate for those 2, 3, 5 minutes, whatever you can devote to the patient, on giving her one extra advice than what you have given her before. So don't lose out on that opportunity, because that's the most important time and that's the most important period where you can have an impact on not only that patient, but on the future generations. And so preconception counseling is very important. I'm not going to tell you the details. This is an overview of the whole concept. And preconception counseling or care can have impacts on all these. I don't have to enumerate. You can take the presentation and